dispensary and medical marijuana industry, or if they just want to use the information to further their education, depending on what electives they're taking or what science or biochem courses they're taking as well. So today we're going to talk about the overview of the Pennsylvania's medical marijuana program. We'll explain the qualifying conditions, the science behind the stigma. Hopefully I won't make anyone hit the snooze button during that. I won't go into too detail, but we'll talk about THC, CBD, what those are, and terpenes of the plant, and how we can use those three things to pick the best medication for the patient. The available products in Pennsylvania, the patient and caregiver registration, certified physicians and how to find those online, also the pharmacist role and dispensary relationship, and then we'll have some time for a Q&A. So how did we get here? April 17th, 2016, Governor Tom Wolf signed Act 16. This is the Medical Marijuana Act into law. This Medical Marijuana Act was to keep a very medicinalized approach on the program in Pennsylvania. So you may hear a lot, especially now, about recreational and legalization being in process, or some bills coming through to push that process coming forward. But as of right now, I do get that question a lot, when is it going to be legal in Pennsylvania, or if it's going to be? And it's hard for me to tell, but I will say that right now, Act 16, as we are at, is to keep a very medicinalized approach, to keep it very pharmacy related. And also the patients, you have to have one of the approved conditions to be a medical marijuana patient. Pennsylvania is one of the few states to create a specific role for the pharmacists and other healthcare providers. So if you walk into a dispensary at other states and locations, you may not see that there's anyone in a white coat there. There's no physician there, just cannabis industry workers. Pennsylvania is different that way. We do definitely like to pull from both aspects of medicine. So if we're looking at a patient that is trying to get off opioid medication, or wants to switch up what they're using, you can talk to a pharmacist to be able to do that responsibly, and then talk to one of the industry workers to figure out what products are going to be best for you to use. Organic Remedies has partnered with the Philadelphia College of Osteopathic Medicine. So Pennsylvania is one of the first states in the country to be conducting research on medical marijuana. We'll hear a lot about, if I talk about like the science behind it, a lot of those studies were done, either years ago, but never really with patients. So we're doing long-term and short-term studies on new users of medical cannabis. So any new patient right now, technically at Organic Remedies, that's interested in being a research attendee, they can sign up for that. And if they qualify, if the pharmacist thinks they qualify, they will conduct a long-term and a short-term study with a PCOM worker. So basically they will find out how medical marijuana, if it's changed their life and what they're using and how it's helping, depending on what condition they have. So I'm so, so excited to see where that ends up in the next, 3 to 5 years. It can really be groundbreaking depending on, the information that we get with that study, which I'm very excited about. So the law itself requires extensive seed to sale tracking, which basically means every single thing that you purchase at a dispensary is tracked from the moment it gets planted into the ground to when it is sold to the patient and dispensed. So everything is tracked and lab tested. So that's another thing that differs Pennsylvania from other states. There will not be any added agents to any of the product. There will not, everything is an organic matter, and also there will be, they test for mold and any, harmful agents that any chemicals that, that wouldn't, get passed through or could be, considered harmful. So everything is tracked that way to make sure it's, safest for the patient and human consumption. Specialized training for the physicians and pharmacists, nurse practitioners, physician assistants, depending on who they have working in the dispensary, we all have to go through training pretty much weekly at this point on medical marijuana. We take that very serious. So we want to make sure that, you know, we're giving the best information out, and any employee that we have and is working the dispensary, you know, knows about what the form and what strains can cause, you know, what effects for the patients. So we want to make sure that we are doing that the best we can. And also, patients must qualify for medical marijuana card based on the past medical history. So basically, I hear the word being thrown around a lot, saying, you know, they are prescribed a medical marijuana card. Nothing is really prescribed. It's actually just recommended. So it would be a physician saying that you know, they have one of these conditions, which we'll go down the list here now, talking about the 23 approved conditions. And basically, if they have one of those, they have to already have seen a doctor to have a diagnosis, but it can't be like new medical history that they're trying medical marijuana. It's if other medications have failed them. So that's again saying, you know, that it's just recommended, that this is kind of if they've tried other medications and it just didn't work out, they're going to try this to see if it works any better for them or has less harmful side effects, excuse me. So ALS, autism, anxiety disorders is the number one condition and chronic pain. And the other ones kind of, we'll go down the list, but have a lot to do with inflammatory disorders and also any like neuropathy disorder as well. So inflammatory bowel disease, intractable seizures, multiple sclerosis. And you'll see the one here, the severe chronic intractable pain. This is the most common one in Pennsylvania. So basically, if they have been on opiate therapy for a amount of time and it's becoming, you know, if the pain practitioner does not want to recommend, you know, the medication, or if it's becoming ineffective, or if the side effects is just, you know, not what they want, they will try medical marijuana to see if it'll help them. Also, post-traumatic stress disorder, this kind of goes hand in hand with the anxiety diagnosis as well. And we do see quite a few patients of these here. So a little bit of a closer look would be a dosage form. So this is, again, if other therapeutic options have been exhausted. So the physician may specify, so whenever you get told by a physician that medical marijuana may be suitable for you, or if you bring that up to your physician, the physician you are working with, that this is not with the dispensary, this would be, you know, the physician that would just basically recommend you to have a medical marijuana card, would specify a dosage form. They don't have to do this. Some, you know, don't have any hands-on say really of what, you know, they would use, but some practitioners do. And depending too, if they are a pediatric patient, you know, they may specify saying, you know, they're not, no vape or no, you know, flower form of it. They would, you know, have a, or if they have an inflammatory disorder in the GI tract, you know, they wouldn't want to have a tablet because they might not absorb that. But that's also kind of left to the recommendation of the dispensary worker or the pharmacist. So a little bit about the science behind the stigma, marijuana and phytocannabinoids. So basically, every being has two receptors, the CB1 and CB2 receptor. The CB1 receptor is found in the brain and the nervous system, and the CB2 receptor is found in the organs and the immune system. The CB1 receptor in the nervous tissue can help with appetite stimulation, pain suppression, any perception changes, muscle relaxation, and seizure suppression. So whenever you go for a run and you get that euphoric feeling, that basically is a runner's high. Whenever you consume marijuana, it activates those same receptors. So that's if you control of how much you are using, that can cause the same type of euphoria feeling, but that's kind of a way to compare those CB1 receptors in the nervous tissue. The CB2 receptor is in your immune cells, and this can help with pain suppression and anti-inflammatory. So basically, you are helping these two receptors in your body work better or work more efficiently whenever you use medical marijuana, which is why it can cause the effects it does for you. So a little bit about the cannabinoids. Cannabinoids is basically a fancy word for saying the chemicals that are naturally occurring in the plant. And they affect those CB1 and CB2 receptors. THC is a part of the chemical of the plant, the cannabinoid of the plant, that induces an intoxicating feeling. So if you turn on your TV and you see Cheech and Chong up in smoke, which is nothing like our medical marijuana program, but they were most likely using things with only THC in them or high amounts of THC. These can give you an intoxicating high if you use too much or don't use it the recommended way. And also, depending on what strains of plant you're using, this can definitely vary in levels, depending on what strain it is and the potency of it. But on the other hand, if you're using it medicinally and use it with the recommended dosage form and the right strain for your condition, this can help amazingly with pain, stress, nausea, appetite loss, and sleep disorders, especially the nausea part. They kind of have the saying, if you use THC, it can give you the munchy effect. Well, whenever you use something with higher THC, especially if you were like a cancer patient going through chemotherapy, or if you have an inflammatory disorders in the GI tract, these can help an amazing amount, helping with the nausea and appetite loss that can come with those two. CBD, on the other hand, is just another chemical that's in the plant, different than hemp-based CBD, so I will talk about the difference of those. But CBD does not induce a high at all. It can counteract the THC intoxicating effects. So whenever you are using medical marijuana, often you will see either equal ratios or some traces of CBD to kind of pull down the psychoactive effect. I always say a way to look at it is CBD kind of brings you back home. So if you use something with a high amount of THC and you don't like the way you feel, if you start, I'll talk about the side effects of it, if you do use a little too much, but if you're feeling too euphoric or high and just want to feel, yourself again, you can use something with a higher CBD and it can bring that intoxicating effects down. Now CBD is amazing for any inflammatory disorder. So it can help a lot with anxiety, arthritis, inflammation, and also sleep loss as well. CBD is incredible for patients that have high levels of pain due to inflammation. So anyone with, any arthritic pain and inflammation, even in like the GI tract as well, or if you're suffering with back pain and it has a lot to do with any inflammation or trauma, CBD can help a lot with those. So the available dosage forms that we have in Pennsylvania, we get asked a lot, can I buy gummies or brownies or something that's pretty easy to use, but they don't have those in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania right now does not see those as a medicinal use. They do encourage you if you'd like to make them yourself, but they don't want to market anything towards children. That can be kind of tough when you're making, candy and sweets and goodies. So, everything is in an opaque container, so you can't see anything inside of them, and they're pretty discreet. The top right ones here, that's just an example of one of the growers named Vireo. The one in the middle is Ilera. The one is just kind of shows what it may look like inside, but you would never be able to see that from the outside of the container. So we have solid oral forms, tablets, and capsules. These are good for patients that want a very discreet way to use cannabis. If they don't have any absorption issues, they can take a capsule, and it may take about, depending on their digestive system, about 40 minutes to an hour to kick in, and then it would be a microdose form of cannabis for them, and it would last up to 6 to 8 hours. So that can be very convenient for a patient that can't, you know, dose again during the day or need something for long lasting pain relief. Topicals, on the other hand, are just for localized pain relief. There's creams, ointments, and patches, which we don't have too many of the patches anymore. They were just not very cost effective because they were a one-time use, but we do have a lot of ointments and creams, which are really nice for, you know, patients that have been through, you know, knee replacements or lower back pain or shoulder pain. They can put that directly on the area. It does not cause a high at all. I do get asked the question, will that show up on a drug test? Technically, we have to say it can, but they would have to put a lot of lotion on for it to show present. But we have to say it can, of course, just because there is THC and, you know, cannabis in there. So if you put it directly on an area, that can be really helpful for that specific place for pain. Then we have oral liquids. A tincture is basically a liquid dropper that in Pennsylvania, they are oil-based. Generally in medicine, a tincture is alcohol-based, which in Pennsylvania, they look at it as being a little harsh, and it can be pretty strong because alcohol will absorb right in your cheek. So that can hit you very, very quick. Oil-based tinctures, on the other hand, are a little bit more mild. They will absorb a little bit under the tongue, but mostly through the GI tract. So these are nice for and they're a lot less harsh tasting as well. They'll often have, you know, an orange flavor or cherry flavor. If you put the liquid directly under the tongue, it'll take about 15 to 30 minutes to kick in and will last about 4 hours or so. Rick Simpson oil, some food for thought if you're interested in reading more about cancer treatment and using cannabis. Rick Simpson oil is definitely someone you would want to look up. Rick Simpson oil is a black tarry molasses substance, which sounds kind of scary and intimidating, but it's in an oral applicator, and it's basically just a very, very potent form of cannabis. You will, they recommend the first dosage form that you're using of this is a quarter grain of rice size. So patients that need a long-lasting pain relief and may have some absorption issues, this can be, or a high tolerance level, they've been on pain medication for years, this can be really helpful for someone that needs long-lasting pain relief and just really wants to get out of pain. Using higher dosages of this has been shown. We can't, you know, say that it's proven yet, hopefully with some of the you know, research going on in Pennsylvania in the next 5 years, if we recap on this, I can say, you know, this study shows that Rick Simpson oil helped this condition, and these are the studies to back it. But there are a lot of stories and patients that I've seen get tremendous results from Rick Simpson oil. It is just definitely the most potent product that we have, and you get about 60 up to 100 doses in one oral applicator. So it can be very a cost-effective way to use it as well. Vape oil. So these are for vaporization methods. Vaping, you know, there is a vaping crisis going on across the country and in the world really, but anything that is in the medical marijuana program has no added agents to it whatsoever. So if you are buying, I get asked a lot, you know, I buy hemp and I buy CBD. I'm not saying that those are not effective whatsoever, but just be very careful of where it's from and the source of it. I think there was a study about 2 years ago. They took 20 different CBD products and tested them, and I think only 2% had what was actually in it. So there's no lab testing, because of being federally legal, really, if anyone, you know, wants to grow CBD and sell it, there's really not a lot of regulations to be able to do that. CBD generally hemp-based CBD can help tremendously with some patients. They've seen great results, but just be very careful of where it's sourced from. That's what I always say. Just do your research on the company because, you know, we can say anything from the dispensary is lab tested 3 times before it's dispensed. It's tracked from seed to sale. It's all grown, harvested, everything in Pennsylvania. You can't say that with other companies, but vape oils especially has no added agents. It's just pressed cannabis oil and dry leaf flower, which would be the form that you can see on the, you know, the third picture to the left there, that you would just use in a grinder. And then they recommend to only vaporize medical cannabis. So smoking it, like rolling it in a joint or using a pipe or something, is not approved in Pennsylvania, and you're actually subject to regular fines if you are to get, you know, caught, I guess, with, you know, something along shows that you're smoking it. Basically, they look at it as using too much and not a medicinal dosage form. And vaporization just vaporizes the oil of the plant. There's no burning in that form of consumption, so it's less harmful. So there are some side effects short term whenever you use medical cannabis within minutes with vaping. It doesn't last that long. It might only last an hour, but you do get the effects right away. You may get a cough, euphoria, dry mouth, dry eyes, increased appetite. If you use too much, blurred vision, delayed reactions, you might get very, very sleepy and possible anxiety if it wasn't the right strain for you. But keeping a good relationship with your pharmacist or your patient care specialist at the dispensary, you can really pinpoint on what's going to be best for you to, you know, avoid any of these. Longer term, it's if ingested, if you, you know, ingest too much in a RSO or in a capsule or tincture, the onset can be an hour and can last quite a long time, but it will go away. There's never been a cannabis-related death yet recorded anywhere. So uneasiness, hunger, thirst, red eye, drowsiness, sleepiness, short-term memory loss, and a euphoric feeling. And again, being able to control the form of it can really, you know, pinpoint on, you know, how to avoid these at all costs. Our main line is start low and go slow. So if you are new to cannabis or just starting out and wanting some pain relief and don't really know where to start, we're going to start you off pretty microdosed. So patients that have been in pain for years, if we start them off microdosed, may get a little frustrated in the beginning at times because something might not work right away, or it might just not be strong enough. We are just trying to avoid those short and long-term effects, the negative effects that can happen if you take a little too much. So I always say the first, you know, couple weeks or even a month or so can kind of just be a trial and error process, but we're here to work with you, giving us all the information like of what's working and if you didn't like it and why, and giving us some feedback so we can give you a more educated recommendation the next time around. Normally, I always say about 2 to 3 times we should start making some headway in your pain relief or depending on what you're treating. And it is safe but effective. Again, no recorded cases of overdose or any fatalities using cannabis. And how to get your medical marijuana card. So the first step is to go on the Department of Health site, on medicalmarijuana.pa.gov. This will give the physician list of who is approved. Pretty much any physician can have the opportunity to be able to recommend those with a medical, those who have a medical marijuana card, but they have to go through a couple classes and take a test to be able to obtain that. But there's quite a few in the area. I know off the, you know, top of my head about 15 or so just in Franklin County. So there's quite a few now that can do it. And since COVID, they're also doing this over the phone. You would just have to if you were a new patient with that physician, they would let you know what you needed. But generally, you normally just need to have previous medical records of these recorded conditions if you're not a current patient with them. or you can also call the dispensary and we can refer you to someone. If you're a new patient and want to get your card, we can give you more information on that as well. You go on the Department of Health website and complete a registration by paying for a medical marijuana ID card. It is actually really, really nice. It's steps are completely, you know, clear. You just create an account, pay it if you are on any medical assistance or government assistance. I mean, you pay $25. If not, it is $50. And then once you do that and the physician's already given you the recommendation, they would take care of their part and send it to the Department of Health. And then you're, once you get your card in the mail, the first time I always recommend, please call the dispensary. The first time you see, this is just like any new doctor's office appointment. So you'll have some paperwork to fill out ahead of time, and you have to talk to a pharmacist your first visit. They're just there to recommend the right products for you and make sure you don't have any questions along the way. With COVID, things have definitely changed. So now also, if you are a caregiver, you can have up to five patients underneath you. So I could be a caregiver for five different patients, and I would pick up the product for them and then dispense it to them. You do have to go through a little bit of more background check for a caregiver, not a patient. So if you're a caregiver, you do have to get fingerprints done, which can be tough during COVID. So that process is a little lengthy, but it is possible now. I know things are loosening up a little bit, but since COVID, at least at Organic Remedies, we don't have any patient or caregiver enter the building. It is curbside service only. This was not approved before COVID, so I don't know how long we will be able to do that. According to the Department of Health, we think it's at least going to be till the end of the year, just to keep things the safest possible we can for the patients. There is now another dispensary right down the street, still on Wayne Avenue, called Rise, and you can go in there. So we just think it's best to keep it curbside delivery just at this time, just for less contact, especially for the immune, you know, suppressed patients. And then here's some information about whenever you're filling out to be a caregiver. They're a little picky, but it just has to be exactly as it appears on your driver's license. Whenever you're filling out the information, it will link you to that patient then. And online, there is a list of the certified physicians on the Department of Health site, and there is quite a few, and it shows all of them in Pennsylvania. And again, if you ever have any anyone that has any questions on how to get those, you can always just have them call the dispensary, and we're happy to help any way we can. So a little bit about what's it like to be a medical marijuana patient whenever you're able to come into the building. But right now, consultations are over the phone, but you have the opportunity to meet a pharmacist and discuss medical marijuana therapy. So you ask any questions you have, whether is, you know, I have work, I can't, you know, be high during the day, or any concerns that you have that that you want to avoid. We're here to help you anyway, through any way we can. Or if, you know, I have asthma and I don't want to vape, that's definitely information that we will have on your intake forms, and we'll be able to give you the best recommendation we can off of that information. Pharmacist consultations are always free of charge at Organic Remedies. Mostly that I've seen, they are free of charge across the board, but it's hard to tell with every dispensary now. Appointments can be made at your convenience. So we always say, you know, make an appointment, you know, another maybe 30 days after your first one, just to kind of look at what you've been taking and just see if you're getting the best results that you can be. And then all of our staff are patient care specialists, so they have gone through the training to know about the product and what would work best for what condition, or if you don't like something, what might work better for you next time. So we talked a bit about the Pennsylvania medical marijuana program, the qualifying conditions, the science behind the stigma, the available products, the registration process, and certified physicians. One other thing I did want to touch base on, I get asked a lot about the price. It ranges definitely on the strength of the product and the form, but we say on average, a patient may spend about $130 a month. That is, again, a complete, like just an average, but in general, about $130 a month will get you a couple things to last you through those 30 days. And if you're going through a lot more, I get asked about a limit. There is a limit through the Department of Health of 30 grams a week. That is a lot. So we don't really run into that too often. And if we do, that is the Department of Health would basically get, you know, flagged saying that, you know, this person purchasing large amounts of quantity, but not something we see a lot. With the price being where it's at, 30 grams a month is a lot. So if you think about that RSO I was talking about, that very, you know, potent product, 1 gram of that is about $80. So times 30, I mean, we would get you something more efficient or something that would work better for you if you're going through a product that quick. And that's, you know, information we can definitely, like, we would notice but with the purchase amounts and be able to, you know, give you a better recommendation of what might work better. And then we have some time for a Q&A. And then also I'm going to leave this screen up because it has my email on here. Eric is the CEO, president of the company. So he is a very, very busy man, but I am happy to help, you know, with any process. If you know anyone that, you know, is interested in getting their medical marijuana card or needs some help with the process or really just not sure where to start with it or if it would be a good option for them, I'm happy to help any way I can. And you can always call. I'm in the Chambersburg location predominantly, but we do have two other locations as well. That's an amazing team that, you know, we're happy to help any way we can. So I can give some time for a Q&A and or touch base on anything again. If I skipped over something too fast, just please let me know and I'm happy to help. And I appreciate your guys' time today so much.
Thank you, Mary. I believe I said it now so that everyone can unmute themselves if they'd like to ask a question. I'm just curious, do you see more people coming to medical marijuana like as their first choice of treatment, or do you see more people coming to it because other things have failed?
I would definitely say because other things have failed. Mm-hmm. Even using myself as an example, I in 2016 went through my own health issues. I literally woke up one day and it felt like I just had the stomach flu or something, some type of bug, and it just never went away. And I ended up later getting diagnosed with some inflammatory disorders, but I went through 9 GI doctors going on high levels of steroid therapy, pain medication. It changed my life literally overnight. And I went from being, you know, a healthy, at the time, 22-year-old to sick and, you know, just a little glimpse of what that can feel like. And, you know, I definitely wouldn't have thought, I think like the first time, you know, the first thing you want to do is go to the doctor and get any help you can. And when the medication that, you know, they put me on, you know, it may have saved my life long-term, but short-term made me very sick. I mean, the medication side effects were awful. So I later went to a naturopathic doctor and we actually did consultations just like we are now over Zoom. She was out of Australia and this was before the medical marijuana program started and put me on a very pretty extensive herbal protocol and it ended up changing my life. And I think anything with alternative medicine, it's always out of pocket. It's always cash. And it always seems a little definitely skeptical for someone that's just trying to get relief. But I think until, you know, someone that went through, you know, a health crisis or, you know, something that all they're looking for is help, it's so tough. And now the way, you know, the medical program works, it's hard to have a good relationship with, you know, you don't really have family doctors anymore. You just kind of go to an urgent care or, and, you know, it seems like a lot of that relationship has faded and it's unfortunate because it's important to, you know, have a good relationship with you know, your practitioner, and you know, it's tough. So yeah, definitely I would say, you know, patients, it seems like this is their kind of their last, you know, their last resort of just getting some relief, which is unfortunate, but we do see amazing, amazing results with our patients.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, thanks.
Darby said, thank you for your presentation. This has been very informative.
Thank you, Darby. I appreciate it. Thank you for coming in.
I am going to, we recorded the session, so if you'd like to refer back to it for anything, I will send an email to everyone who registered with the link, so it'll be on our website later.
That'd be awesome.
Anything else you'd like to address?
I think we're all set. I appreciate it so much, though. And yeah, anytime, if anything's ever loosened up and you guys have another lunch and learn, I'm happy to do something in person or even here again if you'd ever like to.
We will definitely let you know. We're hoping to get back to in person soon.
I know, I hope so.
Because, I mean, lunch and learns are great, but when you lose out on the lunch, it's like,
for sure.
Right. But no, thank you so much for your time, Mary. This was a great, wonderful, informative presentation. I learned a lot that I had no idea.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, we look forward to having you again sometime.
All righty. Thank you so much. You have